You know, in the Old Testament, only one priest once a year could come into the presence of God with blood. They tie a rope around his foot. So if he went in there, he was unworthy, they could drag him out because God would kill him. Now, I don't read anywhere that God ever killed anybody. But they still tied that rope around their foot because they were scared of God. Now, and ain't nothing wrong with being scared of God. Sometimes being scared of God couldn't keep you from sinning. Sometimes being scared of God will cause you to not do drugs anymore. Sometimes being scared of God will just stop you from doing all kinds of stupid stuff. And not a bad thing. But I want you to know, when you come into the presence of God, washed in the blood of the Lamb, filled with the Spirit of God, made holy by His blood, made full by His Spirit, He invites you in and embraces you and touches you and ministers to you and tat you on the cheek. Oh, you're so cute. If you're a man, he goes, hey, what's up? Yeah, right. Oh, I hope you don't think that. See any glasses, Lena? Right. I know I stepped on some earlier. Got carried away. I like getting carried away in worship.
Yeah.
I like it when we get past the flesh.
Yes.
When you get tired in your flesh and you get tired and weary. Man, are you going to sing that one more time? Right? You get to that point where you think, man, what should you shut up and preach? At that point in time, that's the time you press in.
That's right.
Begin to really minister to the Lord out of your will and out of your faith. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't feel it and you still do it, mm-hmm. turns God on. Right. It just does. He likes it. And I think I like that He likes it so that I like it.
Yeah.
See, like that. Praise the Lord. So, this morning I want to preach you 2.5 sermons.
All right.
Amen. Excuse me. One of the sermons is about the devil. Oh no, not another hellfire damnation thing. Jesus talked more about the devil and money than He talked about anything else. And what does the church at large really hate for the preachers to talk about? The devil and money. Go figure that. It's interesting. Just a thought, just in case you're thinking that in the back of your mind, oh no, not the devil again. Probably going to talk about money at the end.
That's the second sermon.
That's the second part, yeah. The third part is obedience.
That's the half.
Is that going to be in a different key?
That's going to be in a different key, yes.
Oh, right.
So in John 10, the 10th verse, what does John 10:10 say? Pardon me? Would you stand up and say that really loud? You can do it.
The thief comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come to give you life. Amen.
That more abundantly. So I was thinking this week at the first, because this is the first of my notes, I was thinking, what is the enemy's objective? Why does he not like us? Why does he hate us so much? Because I want you to know the enemy really hates you. In fact, I'll prove that through the scriptures here in a second. So what is his goal? Why is he so mad at you and I? Well, one of the reasons is because God likes those people who don't deserve His love. God loves people who don't deserve His love. We see that in the story of the prodigal son. The older son got pushed out of shape. Why did the older son get pushed out of shape? Because the father had mercy on his son that didn't deserve his mercy. He got pushed out of shape on that, and he had this religious spirit on him, and he'd been serving the Lord all his life. He'd been serving the Father, doing exactly what the Father said. And the Father comes out and He says, what's up, kid? He says, I've been serving you my whole life. I've been doing all these things, and your son wasted your money. And when he comes back, you throw a party for him. You never threw a party for me. So what was his problem? His problem was he had everything the Father ever had, was all his all the time. And he never had a party. I'll just leave that there. Hallelujah. So one of the reasons is that the son didn't deserve it, and the father loved him anyway. One of the other things the world gets mad at us for is in John 7:7, it says, "The world hates me because I testify that its works are evil." When Jesus showed up, he was so pure and so holy, and he testified of his own life, and it convicted people of sin. The world won't hate you because you're religious. The world will hate you because you're righteous. Yeah. And your righteousness will show their unrighteousness so clear, and so, they'll hate you for that. They won't like you for that. When you start healing the sick and raising the dead, casting out devils, preaching the gospel to the poor and things like that, people are not going to like you. They're just not going to like you. Now, if you just feed the hungry and clothe the naked, they'll like you for that. But if you tell them you do that in the name of Jesus Christ, they won't like you too much anymore. This is the world I'm talking about. I'm not talking about everybody. Okay? Now, what's it? Now, and go to Revelation just for a second. I just love the Revelation because it's such a revelation. Revelation, the 12th chapter. And I'll see, we'll see why the enemy is so mad at us. Revelation 12, in the 12th verse, it says, okay, it says, "Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows that his time is short." Here is an eternal being, dwelt in the heavenlies, had angels worship him, head of the earth, king of the earth, and now God has given the earth to mankind, the devil comes and steals the earth back from him. Now in the end days, Jesus comes, cleanses our sins away, redeems us back to God, and gives us the earth back. So the enemy is weirded out because he knows that his time is short. Amen. You ever have somebody get mad at you because you were going to retire in a month and they had still 7 years to go? You know, or you're in jail. You're in jail and your time is up. You got your time. You call yourself short, or you're in the military and you begin to say, "I'm short." And the guys that just got in got 4 years to go, and you're short. You're gonna sail back home in a week. People don't like you when you do that. They're not just happy for you. Everybody, "Oh, you're so fun." You know, it's all right. Now the enemy is mad at you because he knows his time is short, and he understands eternity. See, he has this concept of eternity. Now God has placed in the heart of man eternity. You know, everybody on earth understands eternity to a certain extent because God has put in their heart that thing called eternity. So they know they're not going to die when they die. They have to be convinced of that. You know that? They have to be taught that they're going to die when they die. They have to be taught that there is no God. They have to be taught that there's nothing higher than that. Woo! Praise the Lord. Okay. Now in the 13th and the 17th verse says this, "Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persuaded the woman, or he persecuted the woman who had gave birth to the male child," which is Mary, right? "But the woman was given wings of a great eagle, and she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent. So the serpent spewed water out of his mouth like a flood after the woman, and that he might cause her to be carried away by the flood. But the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon had spewed out of his mouth. And the dragon was enraged with the woman. And he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." I want you to know the first wrath of the enemy was poured out there in Bethlehem and the surrounding areas when he killed all the babies who were under 2 years old and under because of the Christ was born. That was the first part of the wrath. I want you to know that ever since then, the enemy has hated mankind so much, he wants to steal, kill, and destroy all mankind. That's his goal in life. The devil is not okay. The devil, God isn't going to give the devil mercy. He already had him in heaven. He was exalted. He already had given him mercy. He denied that, wanted to be higher than the Most High. And here we are, now the enemy's mad at us for having what he had. Ooh, hallelujah. Now, isn't that exciting? Okay. In John, I think it's 1:12, it says, to the people who accepted him, he gave the right to become the children of God. Isn't that right? The enemy doesn't like us because we have been given the right to become children of God. Now, in John 6, I know I'm leading up to something, don't worry. I'm catching my breath, is what I'm doing. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we invite you here again.
Yes.
We invite you here again. Over and over and over, God, we invite you here again. Have your way right here, right now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Does somebody have a word for the church at this point in time?
I do.
Go ahead.
I think the Lord wants us to know that he hears all of our prayers, all of them, from the very first time we prayed them, not to forget that. He wants us to go in his word and look at his promises in the word and see what it says, see what he says about his promises for us in the word. He wants us to remember the prophetic words spoken over us, either individually or corporately. He wants us to remember those. If we journal, go back and look those up and proclaim those over your life. When we hear the word, we're really excited about it, but then we forget it. He wants us to remember those. Right in the middle of the storm, he wants us to bring those up and speak those out.
Hallelujah. Now I want you to know that I didn't prompt her. She doesn't know what I'm going to preach today. Okay? I just want you to... I didn't say, now Lana, you're going to have to speak up.
No.
Oh, that's great. Okay. Now, another thing that the enemy doesn't like. It says in the 39th verse of John 6, it says, this is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up on the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up on the last day. I've been thinking a lot about everlasting life. In fact, when I was doing this study, I got to a place in there in John, and it says in the 61st verse, in fact, I'll just read it. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about him wanting to eat his flesh and drink his blood, he says, does this offend you? What then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. Help this boy to read, Lord. And he said, therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it is granted to him by my Father. From this time many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. And Jesus got very depressed and pleaded with the other 12 that they should please follow him the rest of their lives. You guys don't have your Bibles on. Okay.
That's not
okay.
What he said.
That's not what he said. Okay. This is what he said. Then Jesus turned to the 12 disciples and said, do you also want to go away? In other words, he's giving them opportunity. Jesus is not the kind of guy who comes and begs you to come to him. God has given us the opportunity to be redeemed back to himself. He's done everything in his power to make that possible for you. And then he asked the disciples, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life.
Right.
Where would we go? We go back? We've been there, done that, got the hat. Got the tennis shoes, got a couple shirts. You know, we got the trip to the Bahamas from that stuff we did. We are done with that stuff.
That's right.
He has the words of eternal life. Here we are at eternal life again. It's so fun to do this stuff. Okay, let's go back. I'll try to do this in order. Okay, so what does the enemy want us to do? He wants us to agree with him that God is holding out on us. Genesis 3, has God said. All right, okay. He wants us to understand and believe that God is not good and that he's hiding everything from us. Now, does God hide things from us?
Yes.
Yes, he does. But he doesn't hide them from us. He hides them for us. So we'll go get them.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like Easter eggs. I mean, if you don't hide the Easter eggs for a two-year-old underneath a big clump of grass. So he can't find it. No, you hide it right out there so the little booger can go get it. Oh, there's one. And his mom's over there going. And his dad's going, it's right here, son. That's your father sometimes. Sometimes he's hiding stuff for you and you can't find it. You can't find it. He just goes, hey. Here it is over here. Come here. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Haven't you said your father do that, your heavenly father?
Yes.
You can't get it. And all of a sudden he says, stupid. Yes. He doesn't call you
stupid.
That's not my kid, that's yours.
Hallelujah. Excuse me, it's to want to prove my point just a little bit. In Job 1, what did the enemy want Job to do? That's right. In the 11th verse, it says, but now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he shall surely curse you to your face. That's what the enemy wanted him to do. And then in, what is the other one? In 2 verse 5, it says, but stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face. And then it says down in 10, his wife, or 9, then his wife said to him, do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die. I love that stuff. And he said to her, you speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. He didn't accuse God of anything. In fact, it says in 1:22, it says, in all these things, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong.
Right on.
Isn't that cool? Didn't charge God with wrong. I've seen people shake their fist to the sky and blame God for a death of a loved one or something like that. The only one who could help them, they're shaking their fist at him. As if death was the final thing. All grief is selfishness, people. If the person's saved, they're in heaven. I mean, what are you pushed out of shape for?
Because I didn't get to go.
Okay, because you didn't get to go. Or they went and left you here alone.
Right.
How could they?
J-Mac.
Yeah. Yeah, that booger. Yeah.
Alone and with all the bills.
There you go. There you go. In Luke 22:21, it says, Jesus told Peter, he says, that Satan has desired to sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you. Did Satan get to sift him like wheat?
No.
Yes. But he prayed for him that he might, and when he was saved, he converted. See what I'm saying? God does not get you out of all the trouble you go through. He brings you through the trouble you
That's
go
right.
through. Always is he there with you. Always is there something going on. Always he's there to touch you and build you up. Okay, so he gets us to think like he thinks, talk like he talks, react to people's circumstances out of fear, worry, anger, and self-serving. I want you to know that this life is short. It's very short, and you only get one chance. You're not coming back as an ant, or a dog, or a puppy. Hallelujah. So we get one chance at this deal. In 2 Timothy, it says, in the last days, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. I don't want to be one of those guys. I pray to God all the time that I might not deceive somebody. Why? Because I'm capable.
Yeah.
I'm capable of deceiving people. I'm capable. Why? Because when I believe something, I want people to know it. That's why I'm here talking to you guys. When I find something out, I want you to get in on it. Jesus was just like that. He says, Father, I want these guys that hung around with me all this time, I want them to come and be where I am so they can see my glory. In other words, he wanted them to get in on what he had. Why? Because he was their friend. It's just like you guys. If you got rich and famous, you'd want me to come up to where you were. So you'd give me $1 million and let me live there with you. Woo, hallelujah. So when we get this place, when we see men seducers waxing worse and worse and deceiving and being deceived. So we hang around people like us so that they might affirm us in our sin or in our pursuit of righteousness. We'll go hang around with the people we want to be affirmed by. If you want to be affirmed in your sin, you can find somebody to affirm you in your sin. You can find somebody. Yeah, right? Or your pursuit of righteousness. You can always find somebody to encourage you in your pursuit of righteousness. You always can. There are a bunch of people here. Every time I see them, they're encouraging me in my pursuit of righteousness. Hallelujah. Okay, so what has this got to do with anything? The baptism of John was a baptism of repentance, right? Okay, when they baptized. And they come up to him and say, John, what do we need to do? And he says to the soldiers, he says, you know, don't be beating anybody up and don't be doing anything wrong to them. And to the tax collector, he says, don't cheat them. Okay? It was quit doing what is obviously wrong and start doing what is obviously right. That was his baptism of repentance. Quit doing stuff wrong. Start doing stuff right. It's not rocket science. You know, oh dear Lord, what should I do in this situation? Oh Lord, this person's starving to death. What should I do, Lord? Oh God, tell me what to do. Give him a hamburger. I mean, okay. God can then both lead us and call us to what we're to do. So when we repent, not only of the obviously wrongdoing, but of wrong thinking. Why? The last part of John's little sermon was that they might believe on the one that God has sent, Christ Jesus. That was the last part. He says, quit doing what's wrong, start doing what's right, start thinking different. And he says, believe on him who comes after me on Christ Jesus. So there's three parts to that. Quit doing wrong, start doing right, believe in Jesus. Okay, now let's go on. Proverbs 23:7, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Woo! Hallelujah. Okay. As I was preparing this week, this thing about eternal life, I didn't know, I forgot that I had a funeral yesterday. Okay? Now, I didn't forget all the way because I remembered, because I wrote it down on the mirror in the bathroom. But as I was studying, I wasn't thinking about that funeral, so I went in to study for the funeral, and God gave me a verse. And then I made up three verses on my own, because I knew that they went along with funerals. But the one verse was, Jesus was talking there in John 6, he's talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood. So the people didn't like it. Jesus was always saying something that people didn't like, correct? Okay, but the one thing he did, at the end there, he asked the disciples, who else am I going to go to? You have the words of eternal life, correct? So in this funeral, that's all I said. That's all I had to say. So I didn't even have to say that this morning. It was for the funeral. So God likes us so much that he will give us ahead of time what we need, and we don't even know he's given us to us. He'll let us go through things, bad things, not for our sake, but for the next guy that comes along and needs the same encouragement as we got when we were going through the thing. So we don't throw our hand over our head and freak out every time something weird happens to us. We just say, oh, thank you, Lord, for this situation. Thank you, God, for allowing us. We're having all kinds of things happen in our church. We have to move the food pantry by the 30th, 1st of March, or May. We got to be out of that building down there. And what did we do? Oh, my God, what are we going to do? That little ass sucker, you know. But no, it's not what we did. We just got all excited about what God was going to do next.
Amen.
And bless those people for letting us stay there that long.
That's right.
Hallelujah. It's just an exciting thing. We can either respond like the enemy wants us to respond out of fear, worry, anger, and self-serving, or we can respond out of this thing called faith.
Yes.
And say, oh, Lord, I believe something good is going to happen now.
Yes.
Yeah, Matt, but what if it doesn't?
Don't screw me up, man. I'm having a good time. I'd rather function like this, even though it appears that nothing might happen. I don't care. I'm having a good time. I'm having a good time trusting God. Cursed is a man who trusts in man. Blessed is a man who trusts in the Lord. You go to the scripture, look up in your concordance, blessed, Blessed is a man who trusts in the Lord. Blessed is a man who trusts in the Lord. Blessed is a girl who trusts in the Lord. Blessed is everybody who trusts in the Lord. I want to be politically correct here. Hallelujah.
Please, okay. No.
Okay. So when we finally come to believe that God is good,
woo,
hallelujah, and that He desires to restore relationship with us, we can respond to His invitation with faith, confidence, and renewed hope. Almighty God wants to have relationship with me. Psalm 40. Somebody read Psalm 40, verse 5. Then I'm going to find out where I'm going next. Go ahead. No hurry. Just one at a time.
Many, O Lord, my God, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are towards us, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be known.
The thoughts that God has for you are more than can be known. So read 17 also, please.
But I am poor and needy, yet the Lord thinketh upon me. Thou art my help and my deliverer. Make no tarry, O my God.
Hallelujah. So here God is thinking about you. His thoughts towards you are so many you can't even believe it. You couldn't figure it out if you had to. Okay. Now, what is a sign of God's favor? Pruning, discipline, leaving the familiar, sometimes prison, sometimes exile. Perfect training for God's purpose for your life. Why do I say that? Jesus said, you know, if you bear fruit, He'll prune you so you bear more fruit. Abraham had to leave his familiar to go to a place he didn't even know where he's going. He just left. Joseph got in prison, sold into slavery by his brothers. Not only that, when he did right, he got accused of doing wrong, went to prison again, and ended up running the country. Moses went into exile for killing the Egyptian, went out there for 40 years in the desert, learned how to shepherd, and when he came back, he could shepherd the sheep. Okay? So it was God's perfect training. So what is the sign of God's favor on your life? Sometimes it's not that you're rich and famous and it's all cushy and wonderful for you. You know, you might be on your way to prison. But God is bound and determined to bring you into your destiny. God is bound and determined to make of you what He's called you to be. God will not quit on you. He will not back up. He will almost force you into being what He's called you to be. He will not quit. He will not give up. He will pursue you like the hound of heaven. He's not going to leave you alone. He's not going to leave you alone. Even if you ask Him to leave you alone, He's not going to leave you alone. Hallelujah. Oh, praise the Lord. I wrote down here, you can rest assured when you cast your care on God, He will take your care from you. If you cast it on Him by faith and get it out there where you know it's His, He will take it. When you unburden your heart, not only will He receive your burden, but will embrace that place left empty by the unburdening of your heart. That's too far out there. You can cast not only your cares on the Lord, you can cast yourself, your heart, and your soul on Him, and He will embrace you. I wrote down here, strong are His arms, warm is His heart, secure is His embrace. Casting all doubt and fear away, He is Father, and He is good. Yes. Hallelujah. Whoever's got the little loudest telephone, look up Jamie Grace, How You Hold Me, and we'll get there in a second, okay? I know some of you guys are like, and then it's done. Okay.
Jamie Grace.
Jamie Grace. Got it already? Well, go ahead and play a little bit of that. Just listen, you guys. This is good. I can hear it already in the background. Is it coming on?
It is.
Huh?
so did mine.
Okay, that's good. I was thinking of God's embrace, and that song came on the radio while I was meditating on that thing. I love the way you hold it. See, when you cast your cares on the Lord and you come close to the Lord, He brings you towards Himself and embraces you.
That's right.
And He becomes your hiding place, your fortress, your high tower, a place that's safe and secure away from everything else. It's like having a good camp. You go camp and have a good camp. You know, the lions aren't coming, there's no wolves, there's no bears, there's no coyotes. You can sit there at night and sing and play and relax and no snakes. Nothing. You have a good camp. Okay? It's a good place. He calls Himself a tower, a high tower. I don't know about you, but sometimes I need a place to hide. When I was a kid, I liked to have forts.
Yep.
We made forts. We dug holes in the ground and put crap over them and made forts. You know, and we'd go down to the Napa River and hang out at the Napa River and swing off the vines into the river. Vines.
Wow.
Vines. Tarzan vines. Did you know that? Pep showed them to me. He's the one that showed me how to do it. Here, just cut it right here. And we swing on vines. So that was a safe place. It was a secure place. It was full of sewage, but it was good. You know the tide was coming in when the turds started floating up the river. It was nasty, but oh, it was so fun. It was way fun. Okay. So, in John 7, it says, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. Okay, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. Why? Okay. In Matthew 11, He says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest.
Yes.
Come, learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest to your souls. Now I want you to know that rest to your souls thing. I got really strung out on that. Jesus said, all through the scriptures, says, return to me and I'll return to you. In Jeremiah 33, it says, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not. The Bible says that if you seek His face, He'll be found by you. Over and over and over, He says, come to me and you'll find rest to your souls. I don't know what rest to your souls looks like to you, but rest to my soul means I'm
safe.
There's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
Rest of my soul. No turmoil, no worry, no contentment. Satisfied. Rest. Peace. He said it. Now, if you really believe the scriptures, you should go to Him. Put it right in His face and say, Lord, Your word says, if I'm weary and heavy laden, You'll give me rest. So I want that rest right now. But it says, and then He says, my yoke is easy. And my burden is light. So if you're carrying a heavy burden at this point in time, it's not yours. You're robbing from God what belongs to Him. So what you need to do is take that burden and cast it on the Lord. Until the thing is on the Lord. Until it doesn't come back on you. It's an act of faith. It's an act of worship. It's an act of prayer. It's an act of discipline. This is one of the disciplines of the kingdom, to cast your cares on the Lord until the Lord has your care and you no longer have it. Until it no longer comes back, it's His care. Oh, hallelujah. There is rest in that. There's peace in that. You don't have to carry that thing anymore. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. A yoke is something you put on two animals like that and they go forward with it. Not one ahead of the other, not like this. No, they both pull together. When you're with the Lord, His yoke is easy. And His burden is light. So when you're carrying a light burden, it isn't a big deal. You don't get pushed out of shape about it. You don't get weirded out. Jesus is a real friend. He wants you to be in on what He's accomplished. I said that a little while ago. Now, this friendship that he has with you, okay, it's not God to ant. Bug. It's not God to bug. It's not master to peon. No, this is friendship that God is talking about. Real friendship. A real person actually engaging with a loving, real person. Ooh. We humans are on a plane to be able to communicate with and interact with a God or the God. He's put us in a place in creation above every other thing that we might have fellowship with Him. You know why He put the stars in heaven? He didn't put them for dogs and elephants. He put them for people to see and to light the night for people. You know why He put the moon in space? To light the earth at night. Why? For people. That's extravagance. That's how much He loves you. And you're worried about what, you know, the outcome of tomorrow might be? Shoot, He's given you a home in heaven, for crying out loud. What are we doing here? Okay. He even said to Abraham, He says, will I, the Lord, withhold what I'm about to do from Abraham? In other words, He's my friend. God does not want to withhold things from you. He wants to tell you stuff that's to come. Hallelujah. And then Abraham says, Lord, if there's 50 people down there in Sodom, you're going to wipe it out? He says, no, I won't wipe it out for the sake of 50. And Abraham says, Lord, don't get pushed out of shape, but how about if there's 40 down there? The Lord says, I won't wipe it out for the sake of 40. Now, can you see God? He's not getting mad. He's not getting frustrated. Lord, don't get weirded out, but if there's 30 down there, I won't wipe it out for the sake of 30. He says, look, don't get mad at me, Lord, but what if there's 20 down there? Now, this is really in the Scriptures. He goes through the whole thing. What if there's 20? I won't wipe it out for the sake of 20. He says, Lord, don't look at your servant in a bad... I always forget how Abraham says it. But he says, what if there's 10 down there? He says, I will not wipe it out for the sake of the 10. And he says, and the Lord went His way, and Abraham went to his tent. They parted as friends. I could see the Lord looking at Abraham saying, this is a guy who got my heart. He got my heart. He's pleading for these people. He's got my heart. I want to save that place as much as he does. Isn't that something? And so we begin to cry out for the lost. We cry out for the people who hate us. We cry out for the people who persecute us. We reach out to them. And God is saying, that's my boy. That's my boy. He's not griping about it. He's not complaining about those people. He's just like Job, man. In fact, Job got into trouble because of God. You know that, right? God says to Satan, he says, you check out my servant Job? Ain't nobody like him, man. Keeps his integrity. He's going to serve me the rest. Yeah, sure he does, just because, you know. And he enticed him into doing stuff to Job. And what did Job get out of the deal? Twice as much as he had before, twice as many cats, twice as many all this stuff. He had a great life. Hallelujah. Now, in Joel 2, we see the early and the latter rain, right? The early rain was when God poured out His Spirit on Pentecost 2,000 years ago. You are living in the time of the latter rain. When God pours out His Spirit on all flesh, does it seem bad in the world? Does it seem chaotic? Does it seem out of control? Does it seem crazy? Yeah. But God has said, in these days, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. On my servants, on my handmaids, I'm going to pour my Spirit out in these days. The former and the latter rain together, and that's twice as much as was at Pentecost. You see, that's the day we're living in. And here's how we sing it. Gloom, despair, agony on me. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. I want you to know that is the way the world is functioning. Everybody I talk to that's in the world, most of them are thinking just like that. Even a lot of the Christians I talk to are thinking just like that. The kingdom thing says in Romans 14:7, it says the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. That does not sound like gloom, despair, and agony to me. In Matthew 6:10, it says, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." That's what God is crying, calling us to cry out to Him. In 2 Peter 1:4, He says, He's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the promises that He's given us, okay? In Ephesians 3:20 says, "Now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think, to Him be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen." Hallelujah! God is not calling us to this world of doom and despair and agony. He's calling us to a life of peace and joy and power. Because He said in Acts 1:8, He says, "Wait in Jerusalem until you receive power from on high. And you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, and the uttermost parts of the earth." I want you to know at that point in time, just a little while after that, they were burning Christians in Nero's garden to light his garden. They dip them in wax and light them on fire to alive. They boiled people in oil. They crucified them. They killed millions of people. Okay? That was the outcome. But they were full of joy and power and peace. They were prophesying and healing the sick, raising the dead, casting out devils, walking in their integrity, preaching the gospel to the poor. They let nothing hinder them, especially the fear of death. Hallelujah. I think this is the most exciting time, because I want you to know overseas, they're cutting people's heads off being Christians. Right on television, people. Cutting people's heads off. Just taking them and cutting their heads off. Cowards.
Well, I never did have a good head on my shoulder.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. An outpouring of His Holy Spirit. In I got to read these two scriptures to you. I found them in a book. In Psalm 67, 1 and 2, and in Ezekiel 39, 29. I'll do the Ezekiel one if somebody wants to do the Psalm. Then. Psalm 67, 1 and 2. Somebody just go ahead and do that.
"May God be gracious to us and bless us and make His face shine on us, so that Your ways may be known on earth, Your salvation among all nations."
Okay. Let His face shine on us. Why? For all nations. Jesus has commissioned us to disciple nations.
That's
right. And it only happens when His face shines on us and we're filled with the Holy Spirit. Because being filled with the Holy Spirit is the face of God. Hallelujah. Now watch this. In Ezekiel 39:29 says, "And I will not hide my face from them anymore, for I shall have poured out my spirit on the house of Israel, says the Lord God." In other words, the outpouring of the Spirit is the showing of the face of God. You are just like Moses. You come into the presence of God and come in there with faith. All of a sudden, His glory is going to be shining off of you. It's just the way it is. You can't get close to God and stay the same.
That's right.
What I'm saying here, don't let condemnation, don't let your sin, don't let your weirdness, don't let what's wrong with you hinder worshiping what's right with God. Go ahead and press towards Him, because He's not pushing you away. You are pushing Him away. Don't do it anymore. Get as close to Him as you can, because in these last days, He is pouring out His Spirit on all flesh. In fact, in the Revelation, in the 22nd chapter, the last chapter of the Bible, hallelujah, I just love this part. In 22, in 3 and 4, it says this. He says, "And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and His servants shall serve Him. And they shall see His face, and His name shall be in their foreheads." Hallelujah. And then the 16th and 17th verses says, "I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star. And the Spirit and the bride say, Come. And let him who hears say, Come. And let him who thirsts, come. Whoever desires, let him take of the water of life freely." And then it says in 20, "He who testifies of these things says, Surely I am coming quickly. Amen. Even so, Lord Jesus, come." Hallelujah. That is our desire. We seek to know Him. We seek His face that we might know Him. We're not only praying for revival in our city, We're seeking the face of God.
Yes.
In many revivals in the past, we've prayed for the arm of the Lord to be revealed, or the hand of God to touch people, right? That's the strength of God, the power of God, the manifestations of God. This time we're seeking His face.
Amen.
We don't want to miss Him. We don't want to see what He's doing. We want Him. So we're seeking Him. Even so, Lord Jesus, come.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So God, we're excited about what You're doing in our city, in our lives. We thank You, Lord, for stirring us up to take hold of You instead of stirring ourselves up to take hold of sin. We thank You, Lord, for these things. And I pray, Lord, this week that You give us a chance to shine. Just give us a chance to shine. And again, I come against that spirit of condemnation that stops people in their tracks. I bind that thing and break its power over these people in this place. And we thank You, God, for this. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. This morning, we're going to receive communion. So if the people who want to do that, do that. And Lord, we thank You for allowing us to give today. We are so excited about this. We are just hilarious givers. That is so weird. We thank You for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
So the word of the Lord to us this morning also was to remember.
Yes.
Go back and dig up the things that God has spoken into your life. And go ahead and get excited about those things and pray circles around those things. Later on this afternoon, we're going to go pray circles around one of the places we're looking at for the pantry.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. So, pray for that this week, that the pantry be in the right place.
Places.
Pardon me?
We should go to two of them.
Two places we're going to go to later on. That's right, we are.
We should.
One of them we might just be our church. Also, praise the Lord. I'm excited about that. It's big, huge. More people. More souls. Children's ministry. Amen.
Yeah.
Closed clubs.
Already.
Pantry. Outreach to the homeless. Showers. It's gone. I'm tired of that. When it was still alive. That great big barn looking thing out there that was the gas station. That was a cool thing. They had that. And tore that down too.
Yeah.
Before they tear this one down, we're going to go buy it.
What's this one?
Huh?
Gotcha.
Okay, one of the ones is right across the street, right across the park there. The old real estate place, H&R Block place.
Yeah.
Right there is one of the ones we're looking at. The other one's the other side of Starbucks there. That building that is gone. Nobody's in there.
Oh, the old clothing place.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah, I know. That's what we want. Huge. We like huge. It's got roll-up doors.
More doors.
And again, road stuff.
You know, we can get big people in there. So pray over those things. Some of you go to Starbucks. You know, pray over that. Go walk around that building. Shonda LaRue around. Yes. This one over here is really good. It's 2,000 square feet. It's plenty big for children's church and the food pantry. Huh? And Regina's office.
Go to Starbucks, get a double shot of espresso, and run around the building.
That's right. Get a double shot, run around. What are those Christians doing? I don't know. Not my friend. Oh yeah, they'd love us.
I don't know what kind of beans they're boiling.
Yep. Praise the Lord. Go ahead.
I talked to the people over here. It was Thursday, I guess. I was in there putting on my makeup, and God said, "I want you to go across the street." But before that, He was ministering to me about, you know, you can have your own office.
Oh.
And I was like, whoa, I never thought of that. It'd be cool to move things out of my, you know, because my office is jam packed.
Grandkids, kids.
I got grandkids coming.
Father-in-laws.
But anyway, so he said, go over there and look at that place. And so I went over and we went over and prayed for Linda. And I said, Matt, I said, God told me to go look at this place. And I had drove by there and kind of peeked in. I couldn't really see anything. And I called the lady. She says, well, this is the code. Just go in there and look at it. And I said, all right. So I came over to the church. I said, Matt, come on, let's go. So we went over there and we finally got in there with the lock. And we walked in and we just went, whoa. Then we walked in another room and went, whoa.
And then we walked in the other room.
Then we walked in the other room and we're like, you got to be kidding me. This is just...
We thought it was.
We were all excited. Small. We had everything all arranged.
Right then.
So anyway, they want $1,400 a month for it, and so I called, and she said, told her what we did. You know, well, I talked to her that morning about it. Told her what we did. She goes, you know what? I'm gonna talk to this guy and see what I can do. What about $750? And I said, we can do it because we've been paying $750 a month. And so
she called back.
She called back and she said, well, he said 900, and I said, well, we can do 900, just because it'll work for the children's ministry and
everything,
you know. And so anyway, we can move in on the 15th. Tomorrow I have to sign the lease.
Tomorrow?
Okay, tomorrow.
We're going to find out about the other one first.
Yeah, but anyway, so when I came home, somebody came driving up, and they said, Regina, I found the number or the way to contact those people over there, that big building by Starbucks. And they really wanted to find the right person to give it away to a nonprofit. I said,
So we're going to find out if that is the truth.
Yeah. So they don't want to be contacted personally, so I have to go through this lady. And so I emailed her last night all the information for these people of what we do as a church. And so so it's up to God. So that's where we lie, you know. But you know, we have to still pay the rent down here, and then it's $900 for the deposit, and then they'll prorate it for just the half the month because we can move on the 15th. And so we're having a yard sale Friday and Saturday next week to raise monies, you know, for that stuff. And I know God, he'll supply
that's
it all.
Right.
You know?
And
he will leave us, and he will lead us wherever we go.
That's right.
Wherever he wants us to go, that door will open.
Yeah,
so,
that's right.
You know,
that's
just
right.
Keep praying. And I was just so excited, you know. And I'm just thankful that how much he loves us, because
yes.
I was just sitting there, just putting on my makeup and thinking, and he says, what about an office? And I was like, that'd be cool, God.
That'd be cool.
Just started out with that, you know, and it's just started, and just by me being obedient to that, and he told me to go look at that building, because I had already counted that building off. I thought, nah, it's too cut up, you know, it ain't gonna work for us. I walked over there and just went, whoa.
So
anyway.
Either one.
Whatever God does, he's good.
Yeah.
So God, we thank you
yes.
for all of that.
Yes.
And so we put that stuff before you, God. We believe that you're going to lead us in the right direction, the right place.
Yes.
And so we thank you, God, for doing this. I mean, really, God, we're walking in faith here. We're not weirded out or goofed up.
Yeah.
But Lord, we thank you for what you're doing. You are so good to us. And Lord, you took the stripes in your body. You really did. Your physical being was broken for us. Your stripes were for our healing.
Yes.
We remember these things.
Yes.
We remember, Lord. And so we take this bread remembering what you've done, God. We remember all your benefits.
Yes.
And we thank you for your body, Lord, in Jesus'
Thanks.
Name.
Amen.
And Lord, you said, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. You say, remember this every time you do it. Remember your death until you come. And Lord, we remember your body too. And right now, we forgive anybody we have ought against.
Yes.
We release them. Right now, by faith, we release them. Our emotions will catch up. We release them. We forgive them because you've forgiven us so much.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for washing us in your blood, not only covering our sins and atoning for it, but actually washing our sins away. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.
Yes.
We thank you for it, Lord. And we take this cup and we remember your death till you come.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, from whom all blessings flow.
What day is the sale?
The yard sale?
Next Friday and Saturday.
Where is it going to be?
Right over by the
food pantry.
Food pantry.
The bulletin.
Yeah.
So if you want to bring the thing, you'll have to bring it on Friday because Thursday night we have hands. Well, actually, we could put stuff in here. If you want to come bring anything, you can bring it down Thursday.
Bring good stuff.
Yeah.
Don't bring garbage, garbage, please.
Right.
But you don't want my washing machine?
No. May 20th at 5:30 at the Grand Shore Resort, Tony Evans is coming. It's a fundraiser for the Crisis Pregnancy Center, so save up some money. It costs $15 or something.
No,
$50. So save up some money.
It's worth it.
Yeah, I mean, the Crisis Pregnancy Center, look what they do.
Right.
So
it's an opportunity for the ladies to get all dressed up, too.
Yeah, I'm going to get dressed up.
This is in Reno?
Yes, it's at the Grand Sierra Resort. Where's the Grand Sierra?
In
downtown.
In our
quarry.
Oh, it's the old MGM. GSR. Go ahead, Mike.
Oh, Claire answered it.
Okay.
Bring the stuff to the food pantry.
Yep.
Thursday.
Yep, to the food pantry.
For the yard sale.
So this is good. If you ever, anybody seen Tony Evans before?
Mm-hmm.
Oh man, yeah, he's so funny and so, he's really good.
Yeah.
He just is a great preacher and he does a great job. So we're going to support Christ Pregnancy Center because our girls do. Trione Daly, if you don't know her, you should. If you don't, pray for her. She runs the Christ Pregnancy Center here. Wonderful lady.
Yep.
She's been at it for years. She's a plotter. She stays in there. She's gone through health, terrible health things, and she's stuck with it. So pray for her. Bless her in Jesus' name. And God bless you all this evening. We're going to come here and we're going to go over and pray for the buildings this evening. So come at 6 and that's what we'll do. So God bless you all. I'll see you.